Hello, welcome to the Hammer Museum. I'm Claudia Bester. I am the director of public programs here. Zamir I druzhbu. I'm very pleased to introduce tonight's Hammer Forum on the Ukraine and Russia with Nikita Khrushcheva and Robert English, and moderated by Ian Masters. Ian is a BBC-trained broadcast journalist who's covered national security affairs for over 25 years on public radio. He's the host of The Daily Briefing every Monday through Thursday at 5, as well as Background Briefing on Sundays at 11, all on KPFK 90.7 FM. Ian has been a senior fellow at UCLA's Center for Strategic and International Affairs and the UCLA Center for International Relations, and he was a consultant to the Center for National Security Studies at Los Alamos Laboratory in New Mexico. Please join me in welcoming Ian Masters.
Thank you, Claudia, and all of you for coming tonight to hear about Putin's new world order. Perhaps it's worth bearing in mind that the last time there was talk of a new world order was under President George H.W. Bush, and his new world order did not last long, and neither did he. And speaking of imperial overreach, I don't know how many of you have visited Fort Ross in Northern California on the Mendocino Coast, but it is a perfectly preserved window into what might have been had Russia's colonized California. Apparently the settlement thrived and the Russians got on well with the natives, unlike the good Father Serra's missionaries from Mexico who used them as slave labor to build their missions that, like Fort Ross, are tourist destinations today. But the Tsar was apparently preoccupied elsewhere with no time for California dreaming, and he sold Alaska to the United States. So instead of ending up with Putin, we got stuck with Palin. And now while some may claim to see Russia from their kitchen window, the two countries, who have no inherent reason to be adversaries, clearly have a vexed relationship that blinds them to how much they have in common and how much they are alike. Two big continental powers, both proud and patriotic, with a similar red state, blue state divide between the urban intelligentsia and the rural religious right. And we have elections, as does Russia, and we have a Congress with an 8% approval rating, although 90% of incumbents are reelected, and they have a Duma controlled by Putin's United Russia, otherwise known as the Party of Thieves and Swindlers, and we have three television networks that broadcast the same news, and they have three television networks that broadcast the same news, and we have an economy dominated by oligarchs, and they have an economy dominated by oligarchs. But of course, we have not snatched chunks of Mexico lately, although we've done that before, along with the occasional invasion. And while Mexicans don't speak English, Ukrainians speak Russian. At least the pro-Russian ones do, but the ones that we support passed a law against speaking Russian, although they are Democrats, even though Putin calls them fascists, and now many on our side think Putin is a fascist, or at least is acting like a fascist. And while on the subject of fascists, one of our guests tonight, Nina, has written a wonderful book about her real grandfather, who was accused of being a fascist, even though he was awarded medals by Joseph Stalin for heroism in the Great Patriotic War. But then he was later called a fascist by Stalin's heirs, and then later called a fascist by Putin's flunkies, all to get back at the man who Nina knew as her grandfather, who was really her great-grandfather, the man who gave Crimea to Russia until it was recently repossessed by Russia, which started this whole mess that we're going to talk about tonight. Is that clear? As one who covers national security and intelligence, looking at the revived strategic competition with Russia, you have to ask, are we getting our money's worth out of the $650 billion defense budget and the 70-plus billion we spend on the various intelligence agencies every year? Do our brains measure up to our brawn? With terrorism on the rise in spite of the trillions spent on the GWAT, the Global War on Terror, and with America's hawks and recycled neocons now selling Russia as our new Cold War adversary, let's look at how we are doing compared to Tsar Vladimir. First, there is the caveat that intelligence is no guarantee against stupidity, and while it is a bad idea to have a spy as a head of state, Putin's regime of Siloviki, the former intelligence officers turned oligarchs turned politicians, represents something new, a geopolitical hybrid of organized crime and national security, the mafia, and nuclear weapons. And nevertheless, but nevertheless, with a seventh of our defense and intelligence budgets, Putin appears to be cleaning our clock. Overnight, his Spetsnaz, special forces, and GRU military intelligence took Crimea from under our noses without us noticing. Primarily using intelligence assets, Putin plays the covert arsonist while acting as the diplomatic fire brigade. With the help of a leaked secret tape recording of our woman in Kiev, Victoria Nuland, the wife of the neocon's grand strategist, Robert Kagan, Putin has managed to demonize the victims of his push, the hapless Ukrainians, and he continues to destabilize their country while avoiding further sanctions. For the past year, almost the entire Polish government has been captured on secret tape recordings, and now that Poland is a frontline state facing the new Russia, we have the well-timed leaks of its foreign minister dissing the US as a useless strategic partner in a subordinate relationship he characterizes in terms of the activities that Monica Lewinsky made infamous. As European leaders begin to recognize how vulnerable their energy supplies are, Putin is looking beyond the current tactics of threatening to turn off the gas spigot to Ukraine. The push is making sure the Europeans remain hooked on Russian energy. According to the former Danish Prime Minister, now head of NATO, Russian intelligence services are using the old KGB playbook of active measures to fund environmental NGOs to oppose fracking for gas in Poland and Western Europe. A strategic use of intelligence to keep the money that finances the Russian standard of living after the Siloviki have lined their pockets flowing east. And although America still has democratic values and the rule of law, admittedly somewhat hollowed out by our money-driven politics, you would never know it. It's embarrassing how on the world stage Russia plays its weak hand of soft power so much more skillfully than we do. How ironic that Putin, who is killing internet freedom at home, is co-opting the transnational digital underground using cyberspace both tactically and strategically, deploying the same soft power that many argue we won the Cold War with, values we've let atrophy into irrelevance. And using WikiLeaks and Edward Snowden to divide us from our allies, not only has Putin captured the global propaganda landscape, he exploits our increasingly conspiratorial and paranoid politics via his English language network, RT, that appeals to the fringes of the far left and far right while feeding America's growing distrust of government. Maybe we get what we deserve, since you can't have intelligence without education. And with anti-intellectualism having gained political traction from the likes of Sarah Palin to the point that the House Science Committee is now dominated by global warming deniers and creationists, America could end up blinded by its own ignorance and delusion. And now with education becoming a profit center and a playground for meddling philanthropists, will education go the way of the intelligence community, where shareholder profit comes ahead of public service and national security? And as our institutions are cannibalized by the capture of government talent through privatization, making contractors rich while impoverishing the nation, will America end up like Putin's Russia? Will Washington become Nigeria on the Potomac? Or will we start living up to the enlightened ideals of our founders? We'll begin with Robert English, then Nina Khrushcheva will speak, then we'll have a conversation followed by extensive Q&A. Robert English is a professor of international relations at the University of Southern California, who studies Russia, the former USSR, and Eastern Europe, and formerly worked as a policy analyst for the US Department of Defense and the Committee for National Security. He is currently working on a study entitled Our Serbian Brethren, History, Myth, and the Politics of Russian National Identity. Ladies and gentlemen, Robert English.
In the brief time allotted to me for these opening remarks, and not wanting to run over and take away from Q&A and our discussion, I decided to forego any effort to give you the latest news from Ukraine, any predictions about how the crisis will continue and hopefully end, and instead simply look at Russia. Right, this is what we're all interested in anyway. What's happening in Russia? What's driving Russia's foreign policy? And because Russia has a centralized and authoritarian political system, most efforts to understand its policies correctly focus on leadership, on the personality and motivations of its leader. But incorrectly, I think, most of these explanations draw a simplistic straight line between Putin, the one-time KGB agent, and Putin, the KGB-style president of today. The main problem with such explanations is that they leave out a point that is not found on that straight line. A key phase of Putin's leadership that we might call Putin the pro-Western liberal reformer. By now you've heard a million times, if not more, that Putin once said the breakup of the USSR was the greatest geopolitical tragedy of the 20th century. But how often do you hear that Putin also said, anyone who doesn't lament the collapse of the USSR has no heart, but anyone who thinks of putting it back together has no head? Or how often do you read about Putin's landmark 2001 address to the German Bundestag, in which he reiterated that the Cold War was definitively over? He emphasized Russia's deep cultural and historical ties to Europe. He hailed EU integration. He declared that a revived Russia sought only closer cooperation with Western democracies. And he stated, quote, nobody will ever be able to turn Russia back to the past. Well, these are just words. Let me turn to deeds and give a few examples of this unheard of, this mysterious creature that I'm describing as the early liberal pro-Western Putin. And I'll remind you at the outset that when Putin became president of Russia at the end of 1999, he inherited from the incompetent and usually inebriated Boris Yeltsin a country that was in deep crisis. Poverty was widespread. Gangsters operated with impunity. Everybody from the news media to government ministers and members of the parliament sold their voices or their votes to the highest bidder. Nobody who had any wealth, from oligarchs to governors to entire regions of the country, none of them paid their taxes, with the consequence that the state's pension, education, and healthcare systems had essentially collapsed. And at the same time, the country was fractured by multiple separatist movements, Chechnya just being the best known of these. Russia at that time was literally falling apart. So, of course, Putin took tough measures to rein in these marauding oligarchs, to halt the unchecked ripoff of national wealth, to enforce payment of taxes in order to restore the treasury, and thereby revive the country's health, education, and welfare, steps for which his domestic popularity soared and has stayed high ever since. But did you know that only under Putin were things like private ownership of land, bankruptcy provisions, and banking reforms finally passed into law? That the communist-era legal framework blocking private ownership of land and other foundations of a market economy all persisted for over a decade, or exactly a decade, under the supposedly liberal, free market-friendly Boris Yeltsin. And they persisted with the disastrous results that the country lurched from one economic crisis to another. Putin even implemented simplified new flat federal taxes, 24% for corporations and 13% for individuals. This made him the darling of Forbes and the Wall Street Journal, at least for a time. As for Putin's foreign policy, how many remember that it was also pro-Western, indeed, as well as word, the early Putin? That from the outset in 2000, President Putin made joining the World Trade Organization a priority, that he followed the US lead on issues from arms control to sanctions against Iran, and that he patiently absorbed blatantly selfish or one-sided US moves in hopes of reaching a broader understanding and partnership with Washington. Perhaps the most important example of this pro-Western, pro-American foreign policy is what happened and what Putin did after 9/11. Putin was the first to express solidarity with the US and prefer official condolences, even before any of our Western allies. Putin also quickly offered both critical intelligence as well as a network of local contacts and supporters in our fight against the Taliban. And Putin also opened the door to US use of former Soviet military bases in Central Asia for this fight against the Taliban, something that brought him withering criticism on the part of the Russian military brass and, in general, the conservative political military elite in Russia. And when recalling the pro-Western steps that this early Putin took and the political risks he took for a pro-American policy, it's worth noting that the liberalizing pro-market reforms he'd launched right from the outset had already brought him withering criticism from that conservative Russian nationalist establishment, an establishment that was politically and ideologically strongly opposed to more private instead of state control, that strongly resisted more foreign investment and foreign ownership in Russia, and that was already furious over so many previous concessions to the U.S. in foreign policy, those of the 90s. Those concessions, of course, included Russia's acceptance under Boris Yeltsin of the first round of NATO expansion to the east in 1999. In other words, and breaking a promise made at the Cold War's end, the extension of the U.S.-led military alliance system into the former Soviet bloc, where the old Soviet-led alliance system had simply collapsed and vanished. So to summarize, as I am arguing, the early Putin was about as liberal, free market-oriented, and pro-Western a Russian leader as we could have hoped for after the fiasco of the 1990s, then what happened to turn him into the authoritarian, state-centric, and anti-Western figure that he's become? Is it, again, as our popular media suggests, merely something like the instincts of an old KGB officer gaining the upper hand? I don't think we need such speculative psychologizing when overwhelming evidence suggests that Putin's turn was much more about good old-fashioned geopolitics, and that it was in large measure, not exclusively, but in large measure, a response to the aggressive, unilateral, and frequently anti-Russian policies of that other new president of the early 2000s, George W. Bush. And the essentials here are well known, probably to all of you, even if we don't normally consider them from Moscow's perspective. They include a series of steps ignoring Russia's security interests, from abrogation of the ABM Treaty to plans for new missile deployments in Eastern Europe. They include the unilateral invasion of Iraq without UN sanction on false pretenses of supposed Iraqi weapons of mass destruction. An invasion, by the way, that not only Russia, but also such American allies as Germany and France also strongly opposed. They include the twisting of a UN warrant to protect civilians into a mandate for regime change in Libya, and a step that has, as in Iraq, utterly failed to produce the stable, democratic, and prosperous state it was meant to. They include a push for Kosovo's unilateral secession from Russia's ally Serbia, nearly a decade after the dictator Milosevic had given way to a democratically elected Serbian government, and international peacekeepers were guaranteeing the security of Kosovo's large ethnic Albanian population. Above all, should be at the top of this list, was another and much bigger round of NATO expansion to the east, taking in not just three, but now seven new members, including several of them along Russia's western borders. Again, the short time I've got for this opening statement doesn't really allow me to go into detail on the Ukrainian crisis, the crisis of the moment, the crisis that began in some sense, at least exploded into the open only late last year. Suffice it to say that many of the popular arguments we hear, ranging from a supposed Putin plan to reconquer the old Soviet Union, or analyses of Putin as essentially Hitler, are patently ridiculous. And incidentally, I would argue they represent one of the worst, one of the sloppiest and most unprofessional chapters, performances by the US media and commentary class that we've seen in a very long time. Instead, desperate to block NATO's planned incorporation of Ukraine into the Western military alliance and the ousting of Russia from its centuries-old naval presence in Crimea, Putin evidently chose to end this Western strategic threat unilaterally and brutally. He simply annexed this Russia-leaning, historically Russian region of Ukraine. Now, I'm not saying that there weren't political and economic, as well as military dimensions to the crisis. Economically, Putin was surely aghast at the loss of influence in an ethnically close country that Russia, since the end of the Cold War, has spent several hundred billions of dollars subsidizing. In other words, at the complete loss of this huge investment in a friendly state on its borders, in an ally. That's economically. And politically, of course, Putin, the authoritarian, is naturally alarmed by revolution in a neighboring country, by a popular uprising that ousts a corrupt authoritarian leader. But particularly when that revolution was partly funded and strongly supported by the U.S. So there is a political, certainly, and an economic component. But I still argue that Putin's motivations were primarily geopolitical, and that Russia's aggressive actions toward Crimea and Ukraine cannot be properly understood unless we see that they are simultaneously defensive in the minds of their architects. I'm out of time, I think, so let me just drive home this point, my central argument, with a quote from the venerable George Kennan, the most illustrious of our 20th century Russianists and the author of the acclaimed Cold War Containment Policy. Kennan wrote the following: "Surely as one moves one's bases and military facilities towards the Soviet frontiers, there comes a point where they tend to create the very thing they were designed to avoid. It is not for us to assume that there are no limits to Soviet patience in the face of encirclement by American bases. Quite aside from political considerations, no great country, peaceful or aggressive, rational or irrational, could sit by and witness with indifference the progressive studding of its own frontiers with the military installations of a great power competitor. Here again, a compromise must be struck with a view to the peculiarities of the Russian mentality and tradition. Let us not operate to reduce the Russian leaders to a state of mind in which for them the only question is not whether, but when." Well, I think in closing, I'll just add that we certainly could have used some of Kennan's insight and wisdom over the past decade in avoiding what I think is a wholly unnecessary but self-perpetuating zero-sum confrontation, escalating confrontation with post-Soviet Russia. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob. Nina Khrushcheva is a professor in the Graduate Program of International Affairs at the New School and a senior fellow at the World Policy Institute. She's also an editor of and a contributor to Project Syndicate and is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations and the author of Imagining Nabokov, Russia Between Art and Politics. And her latest book just out is The Lost Khrushchev, A Journey into the Gulag of the Russian Mind. And she will be signing copies of her book after the forum upstairs in the lobby. Ladies and gentlemen, Nina Khrushcheva.
Thank you very much. Robert, it was a brilliant performance. I must say, Robert English partially responsible for me being in the United States right now because he helped me fill in my Princeton University applications in 1990. So, in fact, interestingly enough, I'm not going to entirely disagree with his presentation, although I'm going to be not as nice on Putin as Robert was, although I'm sure he was very analytical. I do agree with the fact that Putin broke somewhere in the United States, did have a hand in it, but, you know, there is a free will. You don't need to act as a dictator when somebody else is not pleasing in its behavior. Also on the fact that Putin actually commiserated with the United States first after 9/11, the joke is that because there was still that red line that was activated during the Cold War, and while all other presidents were trying to call the United States, and as you may remember, all the lines were tied up, Putin just had the direct line from the Kremlin. Maybe he was that commiserative, or maybe it was just the Cold War luck. So what I'm arguing is, I'm not disagreeing with Robert, but what I'm arguing is that the danger of what's happening today is that were really, and in fact, it's very, very wonderful that the Hammer Museum is having a World War I commemorative event, because what Putin is doing is he's really bringing the geopolitics and the world order into the World War I category. So he sort of is taking geopolitics 100 years back, and I think that's where the problem lies most of all, because at the time we all knew, you know, powers dupe each other. Some get in the way and some get away with things that Robert actually mentioned and Ian also mentioned. And the United States is the worst in that, or so does Putin think. So that's how he sees it today. And some powers, and Russia is included, is always judged by the unfair standards. I don't have time for history right now, but if anybody knows Russian history, Russia is always a victim. And that actually should give one pause. Just because you cannot be a victim throughout history, there's always you're always underappreciated, and therefore you have to strike first. So that is something immediately psychologically is a problem here. I do agree with Putin and with Robert and with Ian that America does have a lot of hubris, and Robert actually just outlined what the problems were in the last 15 years in particular, so I'm not going to go in that direction. We just know too much about the United States, especially in the open media scape, the country that talks about multipolarity or multipolar world and often functions as unipolar, and that was Putin's major problem. But, you know, as an American myself now, I do have to say that for all the American or West, generally, the way Russia sees it, the West, inconsistency, hypocrisy at times. Since World War II, for the most part, we lived in the world of reasonable confidence, civility, and not nationalistic fervor and militant rejections of legal and economic institutions. And this is something that needs to be celebrated. On a larger scale, that system did benefit all, or does benefit all, including Putin, mind you, because he has certainly not been, since he himself has not exercised a rigid Soviet plan economy. I mean, Robert did talk about his beginnings as a somewhat liberal Democrat. I actually had an article in this month, World Affairs, where I outline and sort of talk about very similar things, how Putin started and how it all broke. But as one of Russian prime ministers infamously or very famously said one time in the 1990s when Russia had a financial crisis, he said, "We all want it for the better, and it always turned out to be like always." So we may say that Putin turned Putin because of the United States, some would say because of KGB, but I think what we also need to keep in mind, why it is always in Russia, we want it for the better, and it turns out to be like always. So with the latest events of Ukraine, turn out to be like always, Putin did stand for the world order, and Robert talked about this. Interestingly enough, in today's political discourse, he really became larger than life. In fact, many conservatives who hate him, as you, I'm sure, know, now think that he was a strong leader and, you know, other leaders should be like him, even if they hate him. But also what's interesting, that in Western Europe, the liberals are also very much against what he's doing, but at the same time, and sort of also following upon Robert's comments, is that they actually believe that it's American grandstanding and lack of diplomacy that does exasperate the Russian crisis. So basically, America can do no right. All this conversation about the new Cold War has returned and how it's going to affect our life today, and it does, but we also have to remember that in the Cold War, since they were two polarities, most of all, they were two camps, so to speak, the Warsaw Pact and NATO, there was much more coherency in relationship between those camps, because now it's quite asymmetrical. The way we see it, it's going to it's developing today. And I think that that asymmetricity of the current world order is a problem, because it doesn't really bode well for the world at all, where now, with Putin's example, other countries decide to break international norms, such as when he annexed Crimea. Because if America can, so the argument goes, so they can too. You know, I'm not going to go into why it is not the Cold War. As I said, there is no pact, although it is possible that Putin is going to create one. You know, and you may remember that just a few months ago, he announced Russia is a beacon in conservative values. So I called it the new values pact. When, you know, conservative countries such as China, Iran, Egypt, Syria, there is a newly signed Eurasian Customs Union between Russia, Kazakhstan, and Belarus. So they may create that pact, but so far it hasn't happened. So we're still in asymmetrical environment. But I think what is really something that we need to be very concerned with, not even so much the Cold War, but the nuclear problem, because that's what I think Putin has really put forward in our understanding of the world, because this is the world in which one state or another, one side or another, may in fact start viewing the use of nuclear weapons as a reasonable alternative to its argument, which in the Cold War, neither Soviet or U.S. Leaders contemplate. I mean, they didn't contemplate, at least in their, at least after their existential experience in 1962, Cuban Missile Crisis. I have to say, guilty. But after that, you know, both sides really use that as a deterrence. What I am arguing is actually. I think what's happening with Putin today is that he probably would be willing to take this deterrence out of the equation and use nuclear weapons. And in fact, there have been various threats coming from Russia, not from Putin himself, but from people in his entourage. And there are arguments that either they're out of control. But I actually think that this is kind of policy. It's that bully policy to say that if you don't follow my world order, I will leave myself with this opportunity. And there are even evidence to this. For example, after the Eurasian Customs Union signing in May, immediately Kazakhstan is now getting a nuclear plant from Russia. Then Iran may get 8 new reactors. And, you know, this is not a very comfortable environment to be. Robert and I earlier had a huge agreement or disagreement or argument on the 1994 Budapest Agreement. As you may remember, Ukraine decided to give up its nuclear power for security to be protected by those, the co-signers of this agreement, and Russia was one of them, so its sovereignty should be protected, and of course Russia did not protect it. Robert argued that Ukraine only was de facto carrier of those new, no, carrier, the sort of the geographical location, but didn't have any power. I argue that in fact they gave it up voluntarily, may not be able to use it the way the Kremlin would use it, because they would, but they saved the world the hustle of insisting that they need these nuclear weapons, and these nuclear weapons should be there. So this agreement was not entirely irrelevant. In fact, it was very relevant. But the point is, because it wasn't upheld when Russia annexed Crimea, of course. Really, now every power would want to have nuclear weapons, because that's what that's how the way for power is. You know, Russia, different as it is, always has the same policy drivers. I mean, for 100 years, more than 100 years, in contemporary situation, it didn't change. Security, state. I mean, everybody wants security. That's state interests. And in Russia, it's the un-Western mentality, which is quite interesting. Robert was talking about Putin Westernism, then was duped by the United States, decided against it. I just want to say that I do study dictatorial history, and it's always the same. The West is always out to get us. We love it. We embrace it. And then they're just so nasty and horrible. So once again, I'm slightly suspicious of this kind of arguments, at least on the Russian side. I mean, how many more times we need to decide that Russia is a Western country in Europe, and that whole debate between Slavophiles and Westerners really should be put to rest one time or another. So once again, it just sort of continues that whole, perpetuate that whole formula. Another thing that stays, it's not just the imperial issue that we deal with, the security issue or whatnot. We also have to remember that autocratic regimes don't end well in recent years. And, you know, Libya's Gaddafi, Iraq's Saddam Hussein, and Putin does remember this kind of things. He looks at those leaders and may imagine that similar fate may await him, because if Russia, you know, what happened on Maidan Square and has been happening in Ukraine may very possibly bring changes to Russia. Of course, there is a question whether Ukraine would be successful in moving towards European model. I know, I mean, we all know a few days ago they did sign that pesky association agreement with European Union. As you remember, that was the the originator of crisis back in November. But the fact that they are going to really deal with it in evolutionary terms, it's still a question, because they haven't been able to so far. Although I have to give them a lot of credit for at least trying, unlike us, the Russians. So that's why the conservative values, I mean, because it is also very important here, they safeguard Russia supposedly from the decadence of democracy. And of course, for the Russians, I mean, what also Putin is doing, not only protecting his own rule, but also trying to assure that Russia stands as that great beacon of conservatism and Slavic brotherhood. I'm really looking forward to reading Robert's book on Serbia and Russia, because I was just in Moscow, like, literally until 3 days ago, and I've never, you know, I'm from a propaganda family, you can imagine, and I am very accustomed to Soviet propaganda. I grew up in it. I actually cherish good propaganda. I have to say, Putin's Crimea annexation speech was a work of art. If you haven't read it, please do. Because it really just touched upon all the right buttons, you know, Russian brotherhood, how Khrushchev robbed Russia, and, you know, all these wonderful things, how reformers are not good for Russia and whatnot. But in Moscow right now, I really haven't seen something so unbelievable. That is not only the, you know, Crimea is returning to motherland, but also how Putin is uniting the Russian lands, and he is, you know, all these reformers pledged it away. Yeltsin, Khrushchev gave Crimea to Ukraine, Gorbachev collapsed the Soviet Union, and Putin is actually the uniter of those lands. So what Robert said, that, you know, we very rarely quote Putin on saying that those who those who want to bring back the Soviet Union have no brain. Well, sometimes Vladimir Putin does behave that he's brainless. Although I do argue that actually he doesn't want to bring back the whole Soviet Union, because he's going to choke on that. However, those strategic pieces he can bring back in, and also for propaganda purposes does become the national savior and the uniter of the Russian land, and, you know, perpetuates his regime for as long as it can do. And, it, you know, it's working, because last summer, before Snowden defected to Russia, Putin was, his approval rating was under 50%. And for Russia, 50% is like 15 in the United States. But now it's suddenly at 85, because all this nationalistic us against the West really has been working fine. What brings me to my point of 100 years and how Putin is really taking Russia back from any potential to democratize and evolutionarize, is that when, you know, in at least a century back, when the times, at the time when ethnicity was valued over citizenship, and, you know, we should be more enlightened right now, and yet we are not. So his precedent, what he created in Ukraine, does give a free hand to anyone seeking to reshape international borders and challenge the very basis of that post-World War international system, and brings me back to the nuclear arsenal use, because that could become a very, very important bluffing mechanism, if not the real use. In fact, you know, one of the reasons that there was no military solution to Ukraine, precisely because one of the offenders in the Ukraine crisis, Russia, actually is a military power, not so much because it was not a NATO member, but because it was a nuclear power. And of course, the question is whether the Baltics, the NATO members, would they be protected if, say, Putin decides to defend more of the Russian nationals in the Baltics and Latvia? There is a lot of them. There is, those of you who know Russia, there's a very beloved resort town called Jurmala. And what if, you know, they decide to become Russian because they don't want to be part of a small Latvia but want to be part of the grandiose Russia? Well, the question is whether NATO would be involved, and, you know, the question is yet to be answered, and I hope it wouldn't be. So what I'm arguing that today, world order, we still don't know the resolution of it, we don't know where it goes, but it really entered international relations, entered a stage of very, very, very dangerous instability and volatility, much probably more than any time since World War II. Many researchers like Roy Medvedev in Russia and Robert Tucker, Robert English's father-in-law, great professor, great scholar of Stalinism and Stalin from Princeton University, they suggested that Stalin in his later years was ready to unleash a third World War II to get on top of the world pyramid. And so very similar to what's happening in Russia. I agree with Robert, comparing Putin to Hitler is very lazy and uncurious exercise. Comparing Putin to Stalin is less so, and it never should be a direct comparison. I'm only comparing the formulas that they employ, the strong hand model, the managerial plan for the nation. But there are certain similarities in style of leadership, that is for sure. What I'm also arguing here, that all this display of strong leadership that Putin has been showing us really doesn't make him strong, however, because all political theories suggest that weak states have very weak liberties, and they do have to use military threat to or nuclear threat to, in fact, get on top. For the United States, however, I don't think the military threat can scare Putin. There's been a lot of talk that people like John McCain should become ambassadors to Russia because he's just going to show Putin who is the boss. That's not going to work because Putin does know this kind of games, and you know, for your threat, he's going to give you five more. He's a bully, and I argue he's a weak leader. He's not in a weak position now, but he's a weak leader and he's a bully. And that he does have nuclear weapons. And he may not be able, unlike Khrushchev, who actually backed down because for him it was a balance of power question. It wasn't a determination question. For Putin, it is a determination question, much like it was for Stalin, who luckily, I must say, died in 1953. And so we don't know what that third war could have been, whether it would have happened or not. Once again, probably because Robert English was the one who helped me file my Princeton applications, I also want to complete my presentation with George Kennan, who I was very lucky to be his last research assistant at Princeton. And he often warned, and even wrote about this, he often warned that the U.S. when the U.S. wants to tell other countries how to do stuff and what to do, it really should uphold to its own moral standards, because that's where America is the strongest. And so for the United States to continue its world leadership that most countries have enjoyed since World War II, it really should work on its principles in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Nina. And thank you, Robert, too. I appreciate the fact that there's been so much demonization of Putin from our brain-dead press. So I thought you did a public service there. So let me ask Nina, though, about what happened to Putin, because you talked about that early in the later Putin. He was freaked out by this popular uprising against him from the Moscow intelligentsia. And up to 100,000 people, your mother included, were marching in the streets. And my understanding is that he feels very bitter about that. He sort of feels like, I'm the guy that gave you guys a standard of living and gave you the freedom to make money, and now you're turning on me. And that was a part of why he turned back to the Narod and became religious and went to the red state religious right. Is there anything to that?
Well, it is, but I think it actually happened a bit earlier. I think it did happen a bit earlier. Robert outlined that. So until 2003, I think Putin was very willing, and he was talking. I mean, actually, I think in 2001 or 2002, he said that, I just don't see how NATO is a threat to Russia. Well, and suddenly it became a threat to Russia. But in 2000, so it was a slow process. I think Iraq did quite a number on him. John Bolton, remember that wonderful ambassador to the United Nations? He was quite a character, and I think the Russians really had very difficult time dealing with him. But just to support Robert's point, in 2008, remember, he brought in this little flunky of his, Dmitry Medvedev, the president, 5'4" president, kind of as the
vertically
first,
challenged,
as
say,
the
yeah.
first the first lady of Russia. You know, look, we're so patriarchal, even our first lady is a man. So he brought in this man. He could have amended the constitution in 2008, and he decided not to. So he was still playing the Western game, but then it just was happening more and more. Then there was this rather silly, reset in 2009, and the reset was happening with the president rather than Putin. I mean, with Dmitry Medvedev, and Putin really didn't appreciate. Not that he didn't give green light to this, but when he did give green light to this, like, wait a minute, I am the man who is in control of all of those things. So I think that Medvedev's democratizing efforts really didn't sit well with him, not necessarily because they were democratizing, but because they were coming from, not from him. And Putin is that father of the, he's really that type. And by 2010, it became clear that Putin wanted to go back. He wanted to become president. Everybody was predicting that he was not going to, because it would be self-defeating. And it was clear that he really, really needed that Kremlin job, because just to answering this question, Robert was saying, well, he started well. Once again, if you look at Russian history, they all start well and they all end badly. I mean, look, I'm not being glib. It is the case. My grandmother Nina always used to say that Khrushchev of 1956 is not Khrushchev of 1962. So Khrushchev of 1956 is Khrushchev of the 20th Party Congress of destalinization. 1962 is Khrushchev of the Cuban Missile Crisis. Thank God he backed off, but it was a really different. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. When you sit in that Kremlin, it happens to you, even if you start as a great reformer.
And did the break come? My understanding is that also Putin was really upset with Medvedev over he felt that he got had by the West over Libya, and that they've had a non-relationship ever since.
Probably Nina could say more about that than I. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't give that much time. I don't mean to cut it off, but yeah. By this time, I mean, the interesting question, we're agreeing that there was a reformist side to Putin who hadn't yet placed his bet on state-centric authoritarianism, had not grown so corrupt, and had not become entrenched with this network of new oligarchs after he unseated some of the old ones, that he still thought he could get something from the West and integrate economically, politically. There was something to be gained. Not that he was a Democrat or liberal at heart, but even in an instrumental way that this might work for Russia. But by 2003, 2004, partly because of his own proclivities, partly because of unforeseen world events that can't be blamed on the U.S., but also partly because of the things that most of us probably, I've always showed this at the ballot box, disagree that the George Bush presidency did, helped push, he was gone. I mean, he became the corrupt, clinging to power, more interested in his own personal wealth and glory. So whether he was particularly angry with Medvedev over this or something irritated him, it's just, I don't know. And by then, the real Rubicon had been crossed.
I'm sorry I asked that question.
No, sorry. that's my rambling way of saying I don't know how to answer it.
Okay. So let me ask another question. And we get to Q&A. This former senior MI6 guy that seems to be pretty well connected was telling me the other day that he says that, contrary to the conventional wisdom, that Putin and Obama have a good relationship. Putin actually likes Obama. He's very different, but he actually respects him. And they have these incredibly long phone conversations, even with allowing for translation. What are they talking about for hours on end?
See, I don't want to disagree with your...
You can disagree with me.
I don't believe it.
Uh-huh.
I don't think Putin likes minorities. Whatever we see what happened in Chechnya, I mean, we all remember those Chechen wars. These are people who are... He's a grand Russian. And everybody else who is not grand white man is just... It's Shonya. Just not what he... Well, I don't want to say he's racist because I don't know, but I just see in his behavior that he doesn't like minorities. And for him, Barack Obama is a minority. Barack Obama is a tall minority. So that's important. For somebody who is 5'7" and want to be the father of a nation of 9 time zones, which is basically 11 time zones until Medvedev democratically cut it to 9. I don't believe that he likes Obama. I think he wants Obama to... Obama wants him to like him. And Putin is basically saying in his mind that the more you want me to like you, I'm not going to. And I think what they're talking about, I think this White House, in my just sort of what I'm hearing, is a very talkative White House. They do talk too much. They explain too much, they justify too much, and whatnot. And so I imagine that a lot of this is happening from the Obama side, but also from Putin's side. He likes to lecture. He grew to like to lecture. So and we saw that, by the way, when Barack Obama, with a reset, he came in 2009, and Barack Obama came to visit Putin in his country house, and Putin lectured him for 40 minutes. So I think that's how the conversations go. Putin's saying, well, that's what you want, but let me tell you, messianic is not good, and I know what messianic is, and you're messianic, and whatnot. We can imagine all this. But I think I think they vent, and I think that's good. That's kind of a diplomacy. When there is no diplomacy, that's what diplomacy is.
Any thoughts on that before we go to the Q&A? I mean...
Could I ask Nina a question on a slightly different track? Yeah. It might not come up in Q&A, so this might be my last chance.
We can do it later.
And regardless of my clearly, in geopolitical terms, in international relations theory terms, I'm giving a realist perspective. But at heart, I'm a liberal, right? I want international institutions to work and trade to bring nations together and all these classical, Joe Nye...
The soft power thing.
Soft power and all that. But this is the reality of dealing with Russia. And at heart, and from my book about Gorbachev and the end of the Cold War, my heroes are these neo-Westernizers, fighting the kind of neo-Slavophiles, if I can put it in those terms. Those who helped create Perestroika and push Gorbachev to do at least what he did, to be as liberal and open and democratizing as he was. So we want the same thing for Russia. And so flowing from that, and I'm asking you this as an intellectual historian, because I'm only an amateur of Russia. I'm only an amateur in that. Why do, when they have their chance at power, the pro-Western liberal reformers of the 19th, the late 20th, maybe 21st century, constantly fail? And I'm thinking not only of the first Gaidar and Yeltsin's, you know, I mean, Yeltsin himself turned and ended the rapid market reforms pretty early on and just floundered for the rest of the decade. They screwed up. The Orange Revolution, Yushchenko, Tymoshenko, when they had their chance, their first chance, and they wanted to join the European Union, and NATO membership was a goal, and they were going to clean up corruption, and they screwed up royally. I'm asking you as an intellectual historian, because I'm going back to Berdyaev and the sort of critique of Russian intellectuals in general, that they are always in a hurry, they're too ideological, they can't compromise. So the give and take and the small steps necessary to get real politics done are pushed aside, and it's always absolutes. If I can't have my entire program, if I can't have a complete victory and impose on you a complete defeat, then screw it, politics, I'll have a fist fight instead. And this was one of Berdyaev's critiques, right? Look at the British, the Swiss. You know, politics is dirty, it's compromise, give and take. And we seem constitutionally, he said, we Russians, unable to approach politics without this extreme morality. Is that part of the explanation for today? Or is it just that the Soviet legacy was so much corruption that it's really not about, you know, sort of intellectual currents, but everyone's grabbing and everyone gets corrupted by what can be grabbed? Sorry for the short and simplest.
As Gorbachev used to say, in your question, there is an answer. No, but it is. I mean, but also if you look at history and you look at the history of Russian reform, any reformer, as I said, first of all, Khrushchev of 1956, if not of 62, Gorbachev, how long did he last? 6 years. So all Russian reformers never last more than six, eight, 10 years. All Russian despots or autocrats, authoritarians, dictators, it's a lot of years. And actually, I do write, this is a little plug, no offense, I do write about it in my book, and I call it the Gulag of the Russian mind, is that we are killed and imprisoned, but our parades are great. We want to be a great country. And the Democrats play the same, they play the same extreme mentality. They want everything. There was a great Russian historian, intellectual historian, Yuri Lotman, who called it paradox of tyranny. That in paradox of tyranny, every next leader who comes in, he wants to, because it doesn't trust the past, and so he immediately wants to delete everything that came before him. That's why Russia is not an evolutionary country, never was, and all the even liberal reformers, they are the same kind of revolutionaries. So you have Lenin or Gaidar, they would be the same kind of revolutionaries. And they come in and they want to delete the past. And of course, you cannot build the future when your past is immediately considered and known and taken as an absolute flaw. So what the country does, the country settles for dictatorship, because you don't want everything to be uprooted and you stay with dictatorial formulas for longer, because it gives you stability or fake stability or an illusion of we were killed and imprisoned, but our parades were great.
Let's have some questions here. There are mics on both sides.
Thank you very much. When the events were happening, I looked at Google Maps and I saw that there were no direct roads from Moscow to Crimea, no train, direct line, the bridge had not been built. So it seems to me that it was an opportunistic annexation. That's my first question. Was it opportunistic or not? And if it was not, how come some people in the Kremlin didn't plan it? Thank you.
Can I grab that? I think
that it was the Crimea invasion of, yeah, you're talking about, obviously.
I think it was opportunistic. I'm basing that partly on insider sources, the best we have of people close to power who report fragments of conversations or the sense of this meeting of Putin's inner circle over November, December, January, February, up through March and the vote and then the annexation. But also I'm basing it on common sense. Putin invested an enormous amount of money, what, $50 billion we're told, in the Sochi Olympics to show Russia off in a positive light to the world, to pull off this amazing spectacle, and in maybe in some sense to wash away the stain of the 1980 Olympics, which we boycotted. And so we're a humiliation. Why would he throw that all away within a few minutes, grabbing Crimea, unless it was opportunistic, unless something else happened, and that something else is this explosion of fury at the reversal in Kiev after the demonstration, the Maidan protesters ousted the Yanukovych government, and some decision must have been reached. The hell with all that goodwill, all that public diplomacy, this is more important because, and as I argue, they foresaw that what was the turn in Ukraine meant in the near future, right, within a few years, they would lose their naval base, right, at Sevastopol on the Crimea, and their last, and that the NATO bases, NATO military installations would come in and replace it. That was his red line, and so he threw away all that goodwill and all that investment in international reputation opportunistically or spontaneously.
Answering your question, what Obama and Putin were talking, according to you, they were talking about Sarah Palin. But, yeah, definitely.
I hope not.
But could they find some mutual ground, like situation in Afghanistan or fighting against terrorism could be started for something? Because it's not in Russian interest what's going on in Afghanistan.
One thing is that it seems like the whole framework of a lot of the analysis on this, you know, starts from the interests of the U.S. government, the interests of the Russian government, and their conflicting interests. But my question, I guess, is the power of the massive struggle in Ukraine and the internal challenge that poses inside Russia seems to get a very secondary, you know, partly funded by United States type, as if it's sort of just derivative of the conflicting interests between U.S. you know, U.S. On the one hand and the and Russia on the other, instead of a powerful mass popular struggle that's having a huge political impact. So I wondered if anybody could comment on that aspect of it, as opposed to viewing the Ukrainian people as objects of history. As you know, what about them as subjects and the beginning to come into politics and having an impact themselves through defense of their national sovereignty.
Sure. Well, since the panel was the Putin's world order, that did get a secondary line, but it's certainly not a secondary line in terms of Ukraine's politics or Ukraine's history. And in fact, it is important for Putin to get really scared for his regime. I mean, there's all these things that we've been mentioning, and one of them is Ukraine could become an example for Russia, and of course, Russians feel very strongly about not wanting that, and Ukraine already did a similar thing in 2004, as you remember, in the Orange Revolution, but at that time, Putin didn't interfere. So that is, you know, that's what makes Ukrainian different from the Russians, and hopefully Russia would follow that example one day. And unfortunately, for the Russians to be able to do that, Russia actually needs to collapse in size, because as long as it remains 11, 9, or whatever, how many time zones, and now with Crimea they got another time zone, so it's just not going to happen. We would be living in that kind of idea that our parades are great and we're a great country and the West is out to get us. So that is a very important question, certainly, and nobody was dismissing Ukrainian masses. I actually wanted to slightly disagree with Robert on that being funded by the West, because it is well known fact that there was actually an Afghan journalist, I mean, of Afghan descent journalist, who, when the EU association agreement was thrown out the window by Viktor Yanukovych, it was that kind of the spontaneous response saying, well, this is my Ukraine, that's the country I want to live in, I don't want to live in. It wasn't anti-Russian in any way, in fact, originally. It was just, you know, why are we, why it is decided for us. And so perhaps it did get some support later on, but it was really a spontaneous revolution. It was documented and known quite well. So I do want to say that the Ukrainians do have this great civic consciousness that Russians did show for a couple of years and then somehow just went away into nowhere.
Let me just add to that that, of course, you're right, and I respect and understand the premise of your question that there's a Ukrainian people and we're treating them as objects here and subjects of great power struggle. But then I would caution, because maybe you didn't mean it this way, but in so many others posing the question in that fashion, there's a kind of narrative underneath, yearning to get away from Russia's embrace and join the West, the Ukrainian people. First of all, I will say two things about it. The first is that there is no the Ukrainian people. I mean, one majority will impose its will or get its policy preferences at the expense of a huge minority. And by the way, Yanukovych was elected by all the Ukrainian people in an election that everyone certified as free and fair, if not a little rough around the edges. So to say the Ukrainian people wanted this, well, a lot of them did, but not everyone. That makes policies complicated. And that's this winner take all. Ukraine has to be the EU's, the West's, and not at all closely tied or subordinate to Russia, or the alternative is a recipe for ongoing disaster. The second thing I'd say, let me put it this way. We've heard Munich analogies, right? Well, along with Hitler. You have to stand up to Putin because he's like Hitler. This is like Munich. We've heard Vietnam analogies and God knows how many others. I would like to propose, in the interests of getting rid of the simplified and romanticized views of what happened and what's going to happen in the future, the Czechoslovak analogy. What's that analogy? It's the following. Why did Czechoslovakia break up and become two countries in January 92? Most of you would say, oh, well, it was nationalism, right? The Slovaks, Vladimir Mečiar, you know, stirring up kind of anti-Czech feelings. The Czechs were arrogant for their part. It was about nationalism. No, it wasn't. That was the froth on the waves. Here's what the waves were. It was economic. When the Velvet Revolution several years earlier occurred, right, in 1989 when communism fell in Czechoslovakia, political power essentially went to the Czech elite. Right, they dominated in terms of numbers, but especially in terms of political influence, political parties, and decisions were made in Prague, not Bratislava, the Czech capital, not the Slovak capital. And they basically launched a classic shock therapy transition, right? Rapid transition to a market economy. So rapid privatization, slashing the state budget, unnecessary subsidies and expenses, privatization, all of that. And within a year, the unemployment went up somewhat in the Czech part of the country. It went up five times more in the Slovak parts of the country. That was the source of Slovak discontent and willingness to follow a demagogue like Mečiar. Now, why did unemployment and economic suffering spike so rapidly in the Slovak eastern parts of the country as opposed to the Czech western parts? Because the Czech lands in the West were closer to the West. They could attract more foreign investment. They had more small, agile enterprises that could restructure fairly quickly and transition. So they went through a very brief slump. The eastern part of the country, Slovakia, heavy industry, coal, arms industry, all collapsed. They lost their arms market because there was no more Warsaw Pact buying their tanks and armored personnel carriers. The other heavy industry, the steel, coal and all of that, dinosaurs, they had to go. Close them down, end the subsidies. Czechs suffered much less. Slovaks were unemployed on a massive scale, much greater scale. That's what underlay it. I'm sorry for this little history lesson or this reminder, but now look at Ukraine today.
Ukraine just signed an EU association agreement. It also has only begun to fulfill certain IMF conditions for aid to ease its transition. Where do you think the pain and suffering is going to come when these budgets are slashed, when energy prices go way up, when the subsidies go away? And where are the dinosaur industries, the equivalents or the analogs to what suffered so badly and helped cause a political split in Slovakia? They're in the East. The East exports almost everything to Russia. Again, heavy industry, especially railway cars. They do $15 billion a year in exports to Russia. Who's going to replace that? Even the most optimistic EU supporters and prognosticators say that the new trade agreement will benefit Ukraine as a whole, maybe $500 million a year. That's a fraction. We're talking orders of magnitude. So here's my prediction. You can hold me to it in a year or two. The separatists uprising in the East, supported, manipulated by Russia, those will eventually be put down. There'll be some kind of agreement, some greater autonomy. But within a year, maybe 9 months, maybe 18 months, there'll be maybe not armed uprisings, but mass popular protests, discontent, and not just in the East, but especially there for economic reasons when this bites. Unless we cooperate with Russia and we can find a way that Russia will continue to sell its natural gas at subsidized prices, that Russia will continue to buy those industrial goods, it just doesn't add up. Ukraine's economy will lose so much. And this is, again, what when I said Putin is partly angry because he's been investing in keeping Ukraine afloat for so long. And this is partly what explained this spike in anger, that investment in an ally in a friendly country, in an aligned country not joining NATO, seemed to have vanished overnight in February. But Czechoslovak breakup analogy, Ukraine has a lot of hard work ahead. It won't be in the EU for a long, long time. It's going to cost a great deal of money. I don't see where it's coming from if Russia's excluded, and the suffering will be enormous.
But why would Putin want to be stuck with the bill with this dinosaur region?
Because he can afford it, because it's a worthwhile investment in a friendly, neutralized country that's not joining NATO, that's not rapidly joining the West, and eventually having military bases, taking positions, what have you, that he sees as hostile. So he wants an Austria at best, a Finland, and he's got the money to pay for it.
I just wanted to go back a little bit in history. Nikita Khrushchev at the UN banging his shoe on the table. I read not too long ago that he thought that was what the United States wanted, that the political leaders of the United States wanted to see force. And he thought, according to this article that I read, that he was doing something to connect to the mentality of the United States. And I just wondered if that's true or not.
Interesting. There's so many versions of this and so many theories of the shoe banging, which, by the way, did not happen. Anybody who says that you saw a shoe, Khrushchev banging a shoe, don't believe your own eyes because you've never seen it. Trust me, you haven't. Pardon me? No, there's no video. I mean, whatever the video is, the shoe is clearly photoshopped into it. No, there is no such thing. I did a lot of research, so you have to trust me on that. Although there was a shoe on the desk, that's true. And Khrushchev, I think, once tapped it, not because what I know. Look, there's so many theories. Not because he wanted the United States, he wanted to connect with the United States, but he certainly, that whole anger that he displayed was in some ways a payback for the U-2 incident. Remember earlier that year there was a U-2 incident, and talking about all the Russian leaders always feel that duped by the West and the United States. Because Khrushchev had a fantastic relationship with Dwight Eisenhower. They really, both generals, they got along, both bold. World War II heroes. And when U-2 happened and Khrushchev said, man, what are you, really, why? And Eisenhower said, oh, wait, no, there's no such thing. There's no planes. Khrushchev said, look, there is a plane. We have a pilot. And Eisenhower said, I don't know what you're talking about. And so, that all kind of anger came out at the United Nations, and so Khrushchev was really trying to stick it to the United States and just to show his displeasure. And I think, I mean, you know, once again from interviews that I had, I think his reasoning was not with a shoe, but he was banging his fists at all times. That one of the reasonings that he had was that, well, okay, you think that the Soviet leader is like that, that we are angry, that we are violent, we are uncivilized, so okay, fine, let me show you this. And so that was a very famous session. He was called Hurricane Nikita, and everybody was just really hoping that he would get out of there. Of their way as soon as possible. But with the shoe, it really was a very strange incident because everybody tells the story very differently. Khrushchev's shoe fell off his it was new pair of shoes, so it fell off his a bit tight. And then somebody brought it in the aisle. He put it on the table, and he totally knew what he was doing. I mean, he could have put it back on, but he didn't. And so he kept it on the table just in case, but he was banging his fists. There have been numerous debates between people who were at the United Nations at the time, and half of the audience is saying that he did bang the shoe and another one that didn't. Sort of my research showed that I think the Wall Street Journal wrote, only the Wall Street Journal, that he tapped it on his desk. But then 2 weeks later, because, you know, the United States has its own propaganda, although, you know, a lot of people believe that it's only the bad guys who engage in propaganda, but we engage in truth. So they have their own propaganda ahead. And so 2 weeks later after the incident, the Wall Street Journal wrote that Khrushchev banged his shoe from the podium. Yeah. Right, and he, of course, was not at the podium in any way. He was sitting at his desk. So this is a very complex story. But the Austrians, you mentioned Austria, good country, central, doesn't want to be enemies with anybody, really had bad experience once. So when the next day after the shoe was on the desk, banged or not, the Austrian delegation sent Khrushchev a pair of ski boots. You know, they have these very massive alpine ski boots, red and white, and saying, well, Premier Khrushchev, if you want to make a point next time, this is the shoe to bang.
Could I ask Nina a question? Because you have so much knowledge and family lore and insight, because of who you are, about something very serious connected to this time. And let's start with Kenan again, our mutual friend. And because he said at one point, or he wrote at one point in one of his famous essays, probably in the... it must have been the mid-1950s, something to the following effect. He said, when we had Stalin, so many Americans were still hoping that we could get along, and they didn't understand who Stalin was. Then we got Khrushchev, the leader we'd been waiting for, and at that moment it seemed like Americans only woke up that there'd been a Stalin, and so this guy must be a Stalin as well. What he was saying essentially was there were, you know, Roosevelt, Harry Wallace, and the, you know, so much sympathy, a lot of socialist belief, so that Americans were slow to wake up to the vicious Cold War goals and behavior of Stalin and hoped for cooperation that never could have been given what Stalin was. And they were so disillusioned by that, or at least the political elite as a whole, that then when Stalin died, and a real reformer came to power, they continued to treat him as if he was just another Stalin. And of course, our Cold War totalitarian sort of scholarship told us it's not the leader, it's the system that makes them that way. So academia, right? This is Brzezinski and Friedrich and so many others, Nathan Leitis, none of them took seriously this change of leadership because the system demands and creates the terror state. So it's gonna be more Stalin. And the consequence of that, Kennan was saying, is that we didn't understand Khrushchev's early olive branch. We probably unnecessarily provoked him, and you gave the Eisenhower episode. which was a small thing. I mean, they were sending spies all over the place too, but it was the personal betrayal and the lying that sort of added to it. And so much else, the Khrushchev's early proposals for general complete disarmament. It took the U.S. like 5 years to figure out the guy was serious, by which time he'd gone out on a limb, his own hardliners, you know, held it over him, you know, your policies are crap, they're not working, it's better to go back to Stalin.
Well, I mean, look, once again, in your question, there is an answer. It is true. But, America has a lot of hubris.
What might have been?
I don't, you know, I actually, as much as I disagree with the viciousness of, not viciousness is not the good word, vigor of Brzezinski's argument, I think the system is to blame. I really do. I think that's that gulag of the Russian mind, is that we ultimately go back to our own circle because we don't evolutionarize. We only do revolutions because that pushes us forward. But because we delete the past, it doesn't move forward. So we can blame the West all the time, and we can talk about American hypocrisy, and you know, they don't. Putin's main argument is they don't treat us as partners because they just want us to fail at all times. It is possibly true, but what's important is that the system remains unreformed. I mean, that's why it was so easy to Putin to take us back 100 years. It is so easy for Russian Orthodox Church, which I'm myself Russian Orthodox, is sort of become so traditionalist, it's almost the fundamentalist religion right now. I mean, it really takes no conversation of any, not even opposition, but sort of conversation of difference in any way. So I think it would not have been different. I think it ultimately would always end up, it would always end up with this. Russia needs to get small. And as a small country, it can't change. The size that it is now, it can't change. We can discuss this for another 100 years.
Well, we've run out of time, so we'll bring you back in 100 years' time. Nina will be up here in the lobby in a minute signing her new book, The Lost Khrushchev, A Journey into the Gulag of the Russian Mind. Thank you both for coming.